This is For Advisors by Advisors. I'm your host, Evan J. Mayer. And today we have a very special guest, Mr. Chris Jeppesen. That's what it sounds like at those First Trust conferences. How you doing, Chris?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me on. And I don't know that I get that kind of applause, but it's nice to hear it.
Well, you know, if you're going, you know, right on after Jim or in between Brian and Jim, you know, that you got to be careful how that all works out, right?
Yeah, no doubt.
This is the chief of advisory practices at First Trust. Chris has been with First Trust since 1997, over 25 years helping advisors through countless events, sessions, and he's also the co-creator of the Advisor Playbook, which I spent a lot of time yesterday reading and listening to some videos. And special shout out to Sean Moriarty for setting up the call. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you very much. And I'd be remiss if we didn't mention the co-author of the Advisor Playbook as well, Duncan McPherson, good friend of mine. He and I have both written a couple of books together. So I always like to mention him anytime we talk about either one of those books.
For sure. Chris, give us a little bit of background of when you got started in the business, what you've learned through the years. You've learned a lot, obviously, but you know, what got you in the business? When did you get started and what's new going on at First Trust?
You know, it's interesting. Everybody's got a unique story, how they get into the business. And I just can remember, I had no idea what I wanted to do going into college. And so by deductive reasoning, I just looked at anyone that I knew, relation or friends or whatever, that seemed to make a lot of money. And I'm like, my uncle RC in Spokane, Washington seems to do pretty well. I think that might be what I want to do. And from an early age, I have had a fascination with the psychology of sales. And when I say early age, the first book I ever read was The Secrets to Closing the Sale by Zig Ziglar at the age of 8. So it dates way back for me. I have just loved and am infatuated with language, dialogue, and the psychology of salesmanship and stewardship and differentiating between the two. So it was kind of a quick road, easy decision for me right out of college. My first interview, everybody's probably got those funny. I remember it was either law school or find a job. And I was ready. I thought maybe we need to make some money to pay for law school first. So I'm at the counselor's office and they got these tabs hanging out on the wall, you know, where it's like buy a washer dryer. And there was one that yep. said, be a stockbroker.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh yeah, that's what my uncle does. So I grabbed that one and it was a regional private brokerage office in Chicago. And I went and interviewed, and you'll get a kick out of this. So I had no idea. Stockbroker, whatever. I just, I thought I'd go interview. So I'm sitting in the lobby in this bank and there's nothing to read. So I grab a stock brochure and just glanced over it, more thinking about what's going to happen in this interview than pay attention to what I'm looking at. So I get in this interview and this manager says to me, he goes, pitch me a stock. The only stock I knew was the one that I had just glanced at barely on this brochure, and it was GTE, okay? So I said, I think you need to look at GTE. He goes, tell me why. I said, well, you know, GTE, they're everywhere you look. You know, they make refrigerators. You know, they make, and I go on and on about GE. And at the end, he says, you know, I think you're talking about GE. I go, yeah, you're probably right. It was a bit of a disaster interview. I did get offered the position. I did. That was my first job, but I just love the business. I love helping people and interacting with folks like yourself, right? I mean, and then it kind of evolved to having a passion with successful advisors and what makes them tick. How are they different? So that's kind of awesome.
It kind of reminds me of The Wolf of Wall Street. Sell me this pen. A little similar there. So, I mean, First Trust has been, you've been there for so long since 1997, and you started out in advisory coaching there. How has that kind of, for the last 25 years, kept you fueled, like to still engaged and loving what you do?
You know, like probably most people, it evolved over time. So I started as an inside wholesaler, then an outside wholesaler, and then a regional sales manager with Nike Securities, then First Trust Portfolio. So this is 25 years ago. And my story as a wholesaler was always lead with what's going to help them grow their business. And you help enough people get what they want, you'll get what you need, right? I mean, that's kind of how I always went about it. So I would just go into an office and say, what's your focus? And it typically would be growing their business, bringing in new assets. I'm like, well, why don't I find out in my little region? They were little back then. My first area was Kansas, Nebraska, Colorado, Utah, Nevada, Wyoming, Northern California, and Hawaii. That was my little area.
Very small.
It's just small. I remember arguing for more territory, by the way. But anyway, it was starting out there. And then I had the sample group right there. Why not just forget what everybody says? Let's find out what they're actually doing. You know, Kurt, you brought in 100 million net new last year. What gives? Well, Kurt's brother, sister's father-in-law sold the business with a $100 million account, and everyone's raving what an amazing job Kurt did, when I know that's not duplicatable. Like, congratulations, but I just keep looking for what are the repeatable, those that are doing it routinely. And then I started sharing that, and before you know it, First Trust was like, hey, other advisors and other regions want to know what these top teams are doing. And somebody has an advisor in New York, Chris, that's doing something unique. Why don't you go meet with them? And so it was just an aggregating exercise is all it was. I didn't want to be a coach. I didn't aspire to being a consultant. That wasn't on my radar. I just was really interested in what made this person in this corner office be so successful in the business, when I, after interviewing them, realized they know about a third as much as the guy in the cubicle who's going to fail out here in the next couple of months. That was intriguing to me. And so I spent my time just studying advisors and sharing what they actually did rather than what was said. That makes sense.
So yeah, no, for sure it does. And I think the interesting thing about financial advisors in general is a lot can be learned. A lot can be taught, a lot can be coached. I just wanted to hear your opinion on this. So obviously when you take like a golfer, for instance, and he's an extremely athletic guy, and you coach him and you coach him and you coach him, and he can do great things, he's got that extra God-given born talent, right? And I think from looking around at the advisors that are great, they have not only great practice management skills, but some are actually born with that. And I feel there is an it to some extent. Do you agree, or do you think that you could take, you know, Chris being in the business 25 years could take a low producer and try to make him an engaging relationship master?
Boy, there are so many elements to that question that, you know, discipline seems to close the gap of the it factor faster than the it factor can be developed with a lack of discipline. That is really the way that I've seen it. There's those that can rest on, and you ask any professional athlete, though, if you play with a professional golfer, ask them how many great junior golfers were out there that never made it.
Yeah.
They were leaps and bounds. You know, the watching LeBron play in high school, you're like, wow, this guy's unbelievable. Like, he's a man amongst boys. There are those, and no doubt it's like, listen, LeBron never needed a coach, and he would have been, you know, decent in the NBA. But when you add discipline to talent, a Kobe Bryant, you add discipline to talent, you get something really special. But you give me someone hungry and disciplined, and they can make a living.
Does that ever drive you nuts in the concept? Like, you go to, I don't know how many events you've done in 25 years, but I got to figure it's thousands. And you meet an advisor, and I've done this. I've gone to an event, and I meet this guy, and he's charismatic, and he's got it. And you're like, wow, this guy's got to be doing million, 2 million, 4 million, 5 million in production. And you're like, hey, you know how I've been doing it for 20 years. How much? Well, I probably do about 400, 500,000 a year. And you're going, man, I wish I could mold that guy. Cause if I ever have those thoughts.
Oh, no question. Well, it's home offices, right? I'll have those meetings with big firm home offices and they're like, you know, Jeffson, what we want to do is we want to get all these people that are plateaued off at 400 and 500 and we want to get them to 1 million. And can you help us do that? And I say no, because I'm not interested in helping someone with the why, because they've got to get their own why figured out. You know, if you want to do this, I'm happy to show the how, but to convince someone to want something, I just find, while maybe some people are good at that, I just don't, maybe it's at this stage of my career, I don't want to spin my wheels. I would rather look at the movable middle, those that are doing 500 to 750, and they're saying, Jeffson, I know what I did to get here isn't what's going to get me to 2 million. I know for a fact. And doing twice of it or three times of the work that I'm doing now, I'm not interested in working three times harder. But I'm committed to making some real changes to my business. I'm just not sure which ones to make first. Man, those are awesome, because that's awesome.
Let's go there. So you got this guy, he's charismatic. He's doing that 750 to a mil. He's just there. What are normally like the one, two or three things that are the quick, easiest fixes?
Well, typically people understand their practice better than I would understand their practice, right? In a short amount of time. So I'll open up with a lot of more discovery probing questions of what do you think it is that's holding you back? And if I were to pull your clients and ask them what your greatest value to their family has been, what would they reply? And if they don't know the answer to that, or they haven't asked that question, then we need to get there, because making your clients the voices you listen to is a great starting point to see where the opportunity will emerge. And we can find out, well, you know, Chris, I've never asked my clients what I do that they find of most value. I said, well, then you must be asking them something that's more important. What would that be? Right. So let's get there. I would have them first look at and do an honest assessment of, and the basics, you know, is it's not how big you can get, not at 750 anymore. I mean, you want twice as many households? Is that how you want to do 1.5 million? No way, impossible. So let's identify who you're best suited for. That whole thing, it's like, yeah, I took everybody that I could at the beginning, but are you comfortable having a conversation with your clients that sounds like this? Hey, John, Mary, in light of recent volatility, in light of geopolitical tensions, inflation, interest rates, stock prices, we have made the conscious decision as a firm to grow our business over the next 12 months from 700 households to 350. I mean, is that a conversation you could have with somebody? Because if it isn't, then, you know, we're spinning wheels, because the only way you're going to grow down, to grow up, move up market, bigger, small, right? Some fewer, larger, then you're going to have those hard conversations. And let's begin with who you're best suited for. So I like to, let's figure out the end first. Where do we want to take this? Some people are saying, it's not about, Chris, I don't need any more money. I'm comfortable on the money side. I want a better quality of life. I'm drained when I get home every day. I don't have the energy to do. I want to go 3 days a week. So we focus more on efficiencies and scale in that way. So there's so many different ways to take it.
Yeah, I guess you're right there. I mean, to me, I never think about quality of life too much, and I should probably. It's probably why I have a gray beard already in my early 40s, but it is what it is. I think building a practice the right way is something we always try to instill in advisors that are starting out, that, hey, you don't need every client, you need the right client. And how are you going to build properly? And I always find it easier said than done, in the concept that when we started, we did pretty much take everybody because that's what we were kind of taught to do. And it wasn't about practice management. It wasn't about fee-based advisory and then adding discretion and all these things that can make your life better and easier and better for the client. Talk a little bit about new advisors. I mean, give them some advice tuning in this podcast of, you know, how should they be structuring their business? What are some initial thoughts that you would give to brand new advisors that just got licensed?
You know, it's interesting. I was yesterday in St. Louis speaking to some graduates that had gone through a training program, and this morning in Dallas, and it was the same conversation. What you just asked was asked at both of those events. And here's what I would say. If there can't, in 25 years that I followed the data, and the most recent data that came out showing the assets, here's the number, 44% of investors plan on moving assets in the next 18 months from their current financial advisor. 44%. That typically around 12 or 13 historically. I don't know if the pandemic boosted this, but three times more than history, 44%. Did you catch the part? It's not they're open to moving or would consider if there was a better alternative.
They're moving.
Or they're planning on. And so if I'm a new advisor right now, congratulations, by the way, your timing couldn't be better because this is where you win. This market right now, this volatility, because I've seen enough advisors that are in a reactive, more of a panic mode that, wait, I just had 14 years of just coasting and doing great. And the client loyalty is wavering. And that advisor that is quick to step up and exceed expectations and deliver a tangible process to a prospective client that is unique from what they're currently getting. And I'll tell you what, they're just these, and I'm talking accounts typically 500,000 to up to 10 million of investable assets. They're telling us, why are they planning on leaving? They're planning on leaving because their relationship has grown shallow. They don't have the meaningful talks anymore. They're lacking a process that is for these types of markets. At least that's what they're feeling, right? Whether it's true or not, perception is the reality. And they want someone that is best suited for uncertain times. And so if I'm new right now, I am getting a clear, concise, compact message on what it is that I do that is competitively better than the alternative, which is the status quo today. And it should be focused around a process that thrives in volatile times.
100%, 100%. Great advice, by the way.
Thank you.
Asking for referrals or not. It's funny, and I think it's different strokes for different folks is the answer on this, but I'd love to hear from you. So I have another advisor friend of mine who it's part of his practice. He asks and he mandates and all that. And I don't. I'm getting enough referrals that I can handle from just existing clients that know the process and what we're doing. And it's not that I'm afraid to ask, it's at the same time that I kind of think it actually works better for me not to, based on my personality and my relationship with the client. But I could be completely wrong. What are your thoughts there?
I have an opinion, but it's probably best that I give the data first. The data is this, the second most effective way of bringing in new assets, the second most effective way of bringing new assets is still asking for referrals and introductions. So, and you could finish the statement, 80% of people would be willing to give you a referral if you only asked. So that's the data. I hope the question for the listeners is, what's the first, right? If you're not comfortable asking, then I would suggest that you don't. Because if you're not comfortable, I promise you it's not going to sound good to the person hearing it, right? Listen, if you happen to know somebody, we could sure use another client about now. This market's not done us many favors. No, I mean, you know it's going to sound like that ultimately, right? And it's just so much better to deserve than to ask, isn't it?
I mean, I think so.
Think about if my neighbor, you can't see behind here, but if they had a party tonight and there's cars lined up down the street and I can hear the music coming from the house and I never got the invite, and would it be a good idea to just knock on the door? I don't know. I mean, maybe. Hey,
maybe.
I know something's going on in there. You want to be that guy? Hey, what you got going on in there? I guess you could do that. or be the person that someone wouldn't have a party without.
Yeah.
That's the emphasis that we try to focus is it's just be referable. And that's the single most effective way of bringing in new assets. And you'll bring in the right ones when you do it that way as well.
Makes a lot of sense. Let's talk a little bit about the advisor age situation. We got a lot of advisors that are getting up there in age. You're probably seeing this at the conferences. The newer advisors are kind of coming in. Succession planning. Obviously, advisors want to get the most they can. We're starting to see private equity deals out the wazoo there. And a lot of that's interesting. I guess my question to you is, what's the best way to maximize your practice, and what's the best way to bring in new advisors to eventually take over the practice?
You know, I just want to just emphasize something that you just mentioned there. The multiples are crazy. That now they've come down a little bit, but they got up to where I was just 18. That's a crazy multiple. What's the difference between the $200 million book that got an 18 multiple and the $200 million that got a 4? And so that I don't forget, if you'll remind me, I know an attorney who specializes in this. That would be a phenomenal guest on the podcast to discuss, because all they do is structure deals and create valuations. And I asked him the question you're asking me. I'm like, I think my advisors that I work with would be really interested if they had to make a couple of adjustments to get the higher valuation on their enterprise. What would it be? And the ones that everybody knows, right? The transactional versus the fee-based. I think most of your listeners are already fee-based focused and lean that way.
If they're not, they may not know how to get onto a podcast anyway, right?
Yeah, you're right, actually. So I think most people are there. I would encourage people, if anything, is remember, first, a client never wants to be at the mercy of a maverick talent. And the older you are, the more susceptible you are to that feeling. And not just that you have to be old. Nobody wants to be at the mercy of a maverick talent. Look, you're young. If you were my only advisor, I would have to, especially with what happened through, you know, the pandemic, COVID, what if you didn't bounce back when you got it? Where does that leave me and my family? Because not everybody did bounce back. And so I don't want to be held to the mercy of a maverick talent. I do want a team behind me. So thinking about teaming is very, very important. That if you're not already expanding it, when growing that team, you grow to the role and the expertise, not to a junior that just is looking to provide you with some freedom. I'm not interested as a client covering your cost of flexibility. I am interested if you're looking to bring somebody on that's going to be accretive to my family's long-term financial picture. Now you've got my attention. If you introduce this person you bring on to me as a junior, I'm going to tell you right away that my money is for starters only. You can give the JV people to somebody else. So nobody should be introduced as a junior. Before you hire, have a clear understanding as to the role to which you're hiring for. What are the activities, responsibilities, and expectations of that person? They're going to want to know it so that they can exceed it. If they're worth their weight, they're going to want to know it. So here's your multiple. Here's, you want to get the multiple. Take it out of your head where it's intellectual property and put it down on paper and it becomes enterprise value. So you take all this process out of here and you put it down on paper and you create a procedures manual. And that's where scale is. It's like a blueprint. It's bolt and go. I got an advisor who's retiring over here, smaller practice, but just looking for someone who can take care of his clients. Well, let me show him our process, our blueprint for transitioning those folks and what they'll be able to expect as a client of our group. Those are things that just a little bit of work on the front end, right, can reap some big multiples on the back end.
Yeah, and you can, a lot of recruitment can come from that too. Niches. We talked about this on a podcast. I had a few advisors that were on that really are niche focused. And then I had another advisor on that's similar to me that, like, it's all about the right client for us. And it doesn't matter what they do for a living. It matters on the personality type and who we want to work with and who sees value and what we can provide. So what are your thoughts on niches? Has that changed throughout the years? I mean, these practice management used to be, I remember 10 years ago, if you didn't have a niche, you were dead. It was all about niches. What are your thoughts there?
Well, I would argue that a successful advisor is your niche. You just described it. You wouldn't think that it's niche because it's not a specific profession, but you described your niche. If you write down an ideal client profile, that's your niche. And for some folks, they will start with, whether it's, you know, pilots, right? If that's my niche. So I start there, but that shouldn't be where you stop, because there's going to be pilots that are the engineering type that maybe aren't going to jive with you, and, you know, that are the fee complain about every little fee, or there are going to be those that don't follow every piece of advice, but some advice. So I would say having an ideal client profile, and if that's within a subsector of a given profession, great. But if it's not, that's fine too. But be very clear on not who you're looking for. That's the difference. Because as a client of yours, by the way, I don't care who you're looking for. That's not my job to look for you. But I'll tell you what I do care about, and that's who you're best suited for. So if you can clearly define for me who you're best suited for, then I know when one of those people has a need for you, it would be a disservice. What kind of friend would I be when I know you're best suited for what it is that they're looking for? It has nothing to do with doing you a favor, by the way. It's all about that friend of mine that I got to sit next to in the pew at church. Now, I'm only seeing you twice a year. I see this person every week. Sometimes we go out to eat on the weekends. Last thing I want to do is go to the restaurant and them say, "Thanks a lot, Jepson. That's worked out fantastic. Haven't heard from her ever since I signed on with her." Yeah, no. I'm not risking a relationship for an unknown client experience. So set out who you're best defined, who you're best suited for, and then deliver that experience. And look, that hasn't happened to me. I don't refer to people that I haven't received an incredible experience with. And then every time my friend comes back to me, my different friends, and they say, "Man, thanks a lot. That really, I can't imagine. I was going to put it all in crypto, Jepson." By the way, that just happened to me. My roofer, because we had a hailstorm here in Dallas, roofing business just went, they make, by the way, the margins in that business, like 35%.
Oh yeah.
They make a ton of dough, especially after a hail season. So my roofer, you know, bless his heart, not super financial savvy, but needs advice. Oh my goodness. Tons of cash and now needs some help. So I said, "Listen, you need more than just where to put the money." He's like, "Hey, where should I put it?" I go, no. You need somebody that can do some real planning for you, because you got a lot of kids. You've got cyclicality that you need to think about when it comes to your business. Let me introduce you to somebody. Here's the kicker. He goes, "Jepson, I just opened up the crypto account. I was going to put it all into there. I think I'll meet with that team first."
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Oh, he can't praise that team enough, because he sees what would have happened.
No, it's those stories that it's the reason we do what we do, isn't it?
No doubt. This is why, you know, this market, this volatility we're in right now, this is why we became financial advisors. Not for the last 14 years. Ah, anybody do less? It's now. This is why we do it, man. This is where we win.
You guys need to create a bobblehead of Jim just saying, like, "It's because of you," and just like constantly, like, you know, so we don't have to go to these conferences every 6 months and get hyped up. We can at least have the bobblehead to press the button.
We should mention, if a listener has not been to a First Trust due diligence, you can't walk out of there with not wanting to conquer the world. That Jim is an amazing motivator.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Especially if you lean with him politically, right? ask this question at the end of the podcast. I think it's a good question to ask because it gives you that ability to say there's that one last thing that maybe I think would be a huge value add to the audience. Chris, if there's one piece of advice you could give to an advisor out there listening, let's just say my audience of one is out there, and the best piece of advice you could provide or something that you would like to get across, what would that be?
Something I've been thinking a lot about, actually, and you mentioned a little bit of it earlier, and it might be the stage, you know, after doing this for 25 years, but when your output exceeds your input, then your upkeep will be your downfall. Be conscious of balance and remember what's most important, the lives that you're impacting, both philanthropically and within the business and your family. Take care of yourself and remember, we just get one of these lives. So make each day count.
Love it. Love it. If anybody wants to get a hold of you, obviously they can contact you at First Trust, but is that the best way or?
Yeah, best way would be through our wholesalers.
There you we know, go.
That 800 number, 800-621-9533, and they'll take care of you. If you want a copy of the book, if they haven't received a copy of the Advisor Playbook or our new Blue Square Method, let us send you a complimentary Kindle version of that for being a listener on this podcast. How's that?
Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Thank you so much, Chris. It was an absolute pleasure. To everybody out there, hopefully you found huge value add and learned something today. I learned a few things today and reaffirmed some things and also a couple things I might need to get working on. So it was an awesome time and we'll see you on the next one. Thanks.
Thank you, brother.